Okay, so RJ, Richard Jefferson, today says that some titles, they just mean more than other titles. I know it, you know it, Golden State knows it. And to me, that roughly translated to Golden State's two titles after 2016 don't mean shit. I mean, you can look at it as RJ just giving praise to what they accomplished in 2016, but the fact that he had to mention Golden State there at the end, I mean, come on, that's an obvious shade. But I'm not here to argue about drama for 10 minutes. As a matter of fact, RJ gave me a great idea. Let's use his criteria of some championships being more important than others, and let's rank every title from the year 2000 to now. I have no clue how I've never done that, but it's actually really fun and challenging because there is not a right answer, and I don't think any two lists are gonna look exactly the same. So I'm gonna give you the breakdown of my list, and if you don't wanna break the screen on your phone, athleticcases.com can help you with that. Most of you have cases on your phone anyway, so they might as well look good, right? Athletic Cases has a ton of options with different player art from different sports, so if you want to try and save your phone from inevitably cracking in style, be sure to visit athleticcases.com with the link in the comment section and in the description. Okay, so I am going to make this list in terms of least important titles to most important titles because I want to save the best for last. And coming in at number 19, we have the Golden State Warriors 2018 title. And come on, do I really need to elaborate? Look, I enjoy watching this team play beautiful basketball. Always fun to watch Steph shoot, he's a great guy. I mean, it's basketball perfection. But come on now. We've known ever since Kevin Durant joined them that everyone was gonna look at their titles a little bit funny. They got to the finals this year, well, they limped to the finals, and they played a Cleveland team that wouldn't have even been there if the Celtics were healthy. This was one of LeBron's worst championship rosters. They played terrible defense, there was really no other stars there, and it's not Golden State's fault that Cleveland was so bad. But watching an all-star team go up against like a second round team at best, there was really no entertaining narrative surrounding the finals. It wasn't competitive past the first game. Long story short, it's one of the most forgettable titles ever, right next to the 2017 finals against the Cleveland Cavaliers, which, it's sad because this could have been one of the best titles ever. Of course, this is after the 3-1 comeback, and if Golden State could have came back the next year and not had Kevin Durant on the team, it would have been much more of a revenge story. We're gonna hear a lot about revenge stories in this list, but I made a video that YouTube actually took down where I detailed why this Cleveland and Golden State rivalry were so terrible, and part of it was Kevin Durant joining it. He joined it when it was like at its peak. You had one year where Golden State won because Cleveland was injured, then you had the next year where Golden State is the best team ever and Cleveland comes back, so now it's like they just need one more duel, right? The Celtics and Lakers in the 80s played each other 3 times in the finals. We just needed one more, like winner take all. And right as we're about to get that, one of the most entertaining narratives surrounding the finals in history, they add what could easily be seen as like the second best player in the league. That's not a revenge story. You guys came back with the last fucking Infinity Stone. Look, a title is a title, and I'm not claiming that my personal record book matters or anything, but if we're ranking all through the 2000s, then 18 and 17 definitely come at the bottom. So in 17th place, and I promise I don't hate you guys, but this is my 2015 Warriors title. Now, I have a really good reason for this. It was the start of the Golden State Warriors dynasty, but it's not just that they beat the Cavaliers when Kevin Love and Kyrie were out, because they can't do anything about another team's injuries. It was the fact that it was much harder for Golden State to beat them than it should have been. Probably better than they would have been on defense had Kyrie and Love have been there. So they were probably a little bit better on that side of the ball. But we were looking at a Golden State team that had won 67 games. They had the MVP. Once Kyrie went down, we all assumed it was a sweep. And people forget, but Cleveland actually had a 2-1 series lead. So that was a title. It was like, yeah, Golden State got it, but it's very hard to look favorably upon a title when you were really having problems with Dellavedova and Mozgov and Shumpert and Smith. No disrespect to those guys, but we're talking about on a final stage. Okay, so those were the obvious bottom three. Now it gets really tough because every championship from here on, these are all really valuable for one reason or another. This is where I had to start splitting hairs, and I think a lot of these will be interchangeable, but this is just the order that I put them in. So next up, I'm going the 2005 Spurs title. This was their third title overall and their second title of the 2000s. Although it was probably the most entertaining final series out of all the ones they had, very entertaining series, but I think the other two titles in the 2000s did more for them. For instance, next up I have the 2003 Spurs title. I think this one was very important to them because it really solidified San Antonio. So the only championship they had won before that was in the 1999 season. That was during a lockout season, and that lockout was worse than the one that took place in 2011-2012. Like, I don't think the season started in 1999 until January or February. It was something really, really crazy. So there was a lot of people getting hurt, and then the Spurs end up winning, and people kind of had an asterisk next to it. They were like, you gotta show me more than winning in half of a season. So 2003 comes around, and Duncan has one of the most underrated finals performances ever. They play the New Jersey Nets, by the way, they win 4-2, and Tim Duncan wins finals MVP, putting up 24 points a game, 17 rebounds, 5 assists, 1 steal, and 5 blocks a game. What the actual fuck? That might be the best stat line in a championship series ever, and nobody talks about it. So not only did that really solidify San Antonio, like, yeah, they're actually here, that right there, that is a really compelling argument to rank Tim Duncan pretty high. So yeah, that's why I think the 03 finals was definitely above 05 for them. And then next up, I have the 2007 title. And by then, we know who the Spurs are. They have 3 titles, they're constantly contending, and the finals was really, really boring. They got there after, it was basically a situation where whoever gets out of the West kind of wins the title. That was the feeling in that season. That's exactly what happened. It was one of the lowest rated finals in history, if not the lowest rated. They sweep the Cleveland Cavaliers, making it their third title of the 2000s, and it was only 2007 at that time. So that solidified them as a dynasty. Speaking of dynasties, now we can talk about the Lakers. Ranking their titles works a little bit differently because their first title actually came in the year 2000, unlike the Spurs, who was in 99. So yeah, it kind of goes in order, honestly. I think it goes the 2000 title. That was very important, and I put this here because this proved that Kobe and Shaq worked. A lot of people forget that they were already together years before then, and they were losing in the playoffs. And then they almost lost. They were like within a hair of losing to the Blazers. But they overcame that, they 4-2'd the Pacers. And that's really important because there's no telling what would have happened to Kobe and Shaq if they lost that series. Like, they had been losing all this time before. So getting there and then having Shaq dominate and then have Kobe really save a game for them even though he had a bum ankle, that was just a start to something very big. Of course, that leads to the 2001 title. I had trouble because I wanted to put the 2000 title over it because, like I said, that's the one that proved Kobe and Shaq actually worked. But 2001, that title really solidified them, or it gave them an argument to be the greatest team of all time. They went 15-1 in the playoffs, I believe. The only game they lost was to Iverson in the finals, game one of the finals in LA. And again, the rest of that series was a wash, not an entertaining series, but it really gave them that argument. And then next where I have 2002, that really put them in stone. That put Kobe and Shaq in stone. Another boring series, but again, this made them a dynasty. The other two were the lead up. Just like the Spurs 2007, it was like, okay, that's a dynasty now. 2002 made the Lakers a dynasty. There was no more questioning it at that point. And back then, it actually looked like they could have kept going. So at this point, you're probably questioning a little bit. You're like, okay, he's got a total of 3 dynasties at the bottom. I've got Golden State's dynasty at the bottom, which is easy to explain. But then I've got the Spurs and Lakers. Well, this is kind of like where RJ was talking about. There are really tiers to titles. And what do you notice about these championships that I've been talking about so far? Nearly all of them have been one-sided. They've been sweeps, 4-1s, 4-2s. None of these championships have really had like a huge narrative around them where it could have went either way. Except for the 2005 Spurs, they're the exception there. But for a majority of those situations, one team was expected to exert their dominance over another. So now we get to this next tier of titles where it's like, okay, these are 2 great teams, there's a crazy storyline behind it, and whoever overcomes this, now it's legacy defining because of what you've done. So that's where a majority of this next tier fits into. And I'm starting with the 2008 Celtics. Their title may seem like it was just a foregone conclusion, and especially if you're too young to remember that, I see how you could see a big three and just think, oh, well, they were expected to. Yeah, they were definitely an expected finals team, but 08 was a big deal. First of all, it was Lakers and Celtics. Second of all, this was Kobe's first chance to win a title without Shaquille O'Neal. And it was in no way looked at like the Lakers were just outmatched and they should just run for cover. It was not like Golden State and Cleveland. So in that series, the Celtics add another win over the Lakers in the whole franchise record thing. Their rivalry with Kobe Bryant officially starts. And then a really important thing that happened there was the big three formula was proven. A lot of people will look at the Spurs and say, well, what about Manu, Tim, and No, I'm talking about like guys that come from separate teams and they are perceived to be the guy on their own team. I'm talking about that type of big three. So those three are joined together. And all of a sudden, that's the formula for a lot of championships for years to come, as we see. Kobe's legacy at the time takes somewhat of a hit because he has proven that he cannot win without Shaq, at least in 2008. And the Celtics and Lakers become a big thing for a few years. So we will return to that. But after them, I have the 09 Lakers title. That's very important because it was Kobe Bryant's first title without Shaq. It left much to be desired because Kevin Garnett got hurt that year, so the Orlando Magic took their place. And the worst part about that is once the Celtics went down, everybody assumed that it was going to be LeBron versus Kobe. That, I have a lot to say about that in a different video. That I hate that we missed that finals. But anyways, yes, that Lakers title, their first since the Shaq and Kobe era, very, very important. So after that, I'm going to go with the 2012 Heat. First of all, it was damn near a miracle that they made it there. It took that Game 6 explosion from LeBron in the conference finals to make it happen. But this is very important because it's LeBron's first title and it's the Miami Heat's Big 3 first title. And it was pivotal that they bounced back from 2011 because of course they had the whole Yes We Did party in 2011. They had basically sworn at that time that they were going to be one of the greatest teams ever and then they didn't even win. So coming into 2012, like, they either had to win or I think that experiment was probably going to break up. I truly think if they had a loss at any point before or in the finals, the Miami Heat Big 3 would have been done right there. So they get there, that is LeBron's first meeting with Kevin Durant. And I'm actually going to do a video about that series on my first channel because although it was 4-1, it was way closer than you remember. But again, think back to the party. LeBron promised them like 8 titles or something like that. So when they came to 2013, there was a little less pressure, but nevertheless, it was very important because now they were going up against the team that first took away LeBron's chance at a title in the San Antonio Spurs. So that happens, they get into a scuffle, and the Heat go down 2-3. At that point, it looked like the Miami Heat were going to be 1-2 in the NBA Finals. Considering the expectations around them, that would have been unacceptable. But what really makes this title is the chain of events that led to it. Or led to the end anyways. Of course, we have Game 6 where the Heat are down basically all game. With like a minute left, it looks over. Then you have Ray Allen who hit quite possibly the greatest shot in NBA history. You got LeBron's Game 6 and Game 7 performance. So not only did that really prop the Miami Heat up when we talk about all-time teams, but it propped LeBron's legacy up as well. The other thing that happened here I forgot to mention is that the 2012 title, just like the 99 Spurs title, it happened in a lockout season. So people were looking at that going, well, especially because it was LeBron and people want to criticize him, they were like, yeah, you got to show me something more. As a matter of fact, I believe he actually tweeted that LeBron's ring wasn't worth anything because it came in a lockout season. So you know for a fact that if Miami would have lost the very next year in a non-lockout season against the more experienced Spurs, on top of how they would have lost when LeBron missed that three before Ray Allen, that would have been pretty crushing. That would have been a crushing defeat. So very important title for Miami, that's why they're ranked so high. At number 6, I am going 2004 Pistons. Think back to when I said the Lakers cemented themselves as a dynasty and it looked like they could have kept going. Well yeah, 2004 was part of that whole could have kept going idea. But it was even worse because they added Gary Payton and they added Karl Malone. They got to the NBA Finals and although Kobe had been dealing with that court case flying back and forth, chemistry was down, there was injuries, they were still favorites over the Pistons because they didn't really have like that type of star. They didn't have a Kobe type star or a Shaq type star, they didn't have anything like that. It was like a total team effort versus a star-studded team. So I do have something important to say here. I think the Lakers would have probably stood a better chance in that series than they did if Karl Malone hadn't have gotten hurt. But either way, that was still amazing for the Pistons to come out and not only win the series, but they dominated it. It would be like this year having some regular-ass team come out and just sweep Golden State in the finals. And you could have Golden State with like chemistry issues and maybe one player limping around because of injury. But you still expect them to, you know, if that happened to Golden State, you would expect them to still go like 7 games, right? Because they're that good. Okay, but now imagine a team just comes up and they just wash them. Yeah, that's the equivalent of 04, so that's why it ranks that high. That's an impressive title, even though it seems like nobody really cares about it anymore. And the Pistons didn't win anything afterwards. For a single title, yeah, that ranks high. At number 5, I'm going the 2006 Miami Heat. And the only reason it didn't rank higher is because of how controversial the whole thing is with Dwayne Wade and his free throws. Personally, I've watched those series highlights over and over again. And a majority of the time, what I see is Dwayne Wade going against defenders that just did not stand a chance trying to stay in front of him. One thing led to another, and the man was getting free throws. Now, I can do a more in-depth video looking at, you know, what calls shouldn't have been made or whatever. But you are not going to take the 2006 finals away from Dwayne Wade, because not only were they down 0-2, but this is something else I had planned. Dallas really had that series won. When they were in Miami for Game 3, I believe winding down that game, Dallas had all the momentum. They were up by a good amount of points. They were about to go up 3-0. And so imagine yourself sitting in 2006. If you're watching Game 3 and it's winding down, it's starting to look like a series where one team is just that much better than the other. It looked like it was just Dallas's time. It went all the way from that extreme to Miami winning 4 straight in like the snap of a finger. A lot of people were saying that that was the best finals performance that they've seen from a single player since Michael Jordan. And Dwayne Wade was, what, only in his 3rd year at the time? So yeah, imagine a 3rd year player right now, like somebody drafted in 2016, leading a team to the NBA Finals, and then taking over it. And nobody can use the he had Shaq card, because Shaq was not very useful in that finals. Definitely nothing close to even what he was in 04. Like, it's very simple. If Dwayne Wade does not take over that series, the Miami Heat do not win. And people still talk about that finals all the time. People want to know about it. So that tells you everything you need to know about the importance of that title. And to put it into perspective, that one title means more for Wade's legacy than the other two combined that he won with LeBron. At number 4, we are going the 2010 Lakers. So this is a couple of years after 2008. This is what should have happened in 2009. This was the rematch we all wanted, and we were so blessed to get it. The Celtics look average all year, but they come back, and in the playoffs, they are their dominant regular selves. And here's why this championship is so important. Again, you have the whole thing with the Celtics and Lakers. Of course, Kobe's already won a title without Shaq, but now people are looking and saying, okay, Kobe might have caught a break last year. He didn't have to play the Celtics, and he did not have to play LeBron. If he goes into this finals and loses to Boston again, that says something about his lone title without Shaq. And then Kobe said this himself in a documentary. He was like, people are going to look at me and say we lost, or I led a team that lost to the Celtics twice. This was their last meeting ever, although we didn't know it at the time. And it was very pivotal to Kobe's legacy that they came out on top because of how he shot in Game 7. So people who really, really watch basketball would look at other things that he did. But the overwhelming narrative would have been that Kobe shot terrible and the Lakers lost. He only had one without Shaq, and that team that he beat was not as good as the Celtics. They would have tore him down. They would have tore the Lakers title down. And that one came down to like the last 30 seconds of Game 7. So very, very, very high ranking title. And to get over this one, you've got to be special. And somehow I find the 2014 Spurs title more special. Here's why. I don't know that there's a more crushing defeat that I've ever experienced than seeing the 2013 Spurs lose the way they did. Not only did they lose Game 6 when they had it won, especially when they had like a 99% chance of winning that game, you know, with the clock where it was and the fouls and all that, then they went on to lose Game 7, and in 2013 that was one of Tim Duncan's only chokes. That one where he was sweeping across the lane, he misses the layup over Battier. I believe that layup would have tied the game. But anyways, they go on to lose that game. That is crushing. Like, I was not even a Spurs fan, and my heart hurt for them. So not only did they make it back to the finals again in a very tough Western Conference, they dominated Miami. They beat them so bad that I wonder even if Dwayne Wade was like fully himself, or at least the way that they had in the 2012 and 2013 finals, I still wonder if they would have been able to do anything with San Antonio because they were just that focused. Tim Duncan, who's usually humble, before that series said, yeah, we're going to do it this time. He feared nothing. Nobody on that team feared anything. And that's easily one of the best revenge titles of all time. So number 2 could be considered revenge, but there's more to it than that. The 2011 Mavericks get the second best title of the 2000s, and it's one of those unimaginable runs that nobody even thought was going to happen. Like, going into the 2011 playoffs, nobody was looking and saying, oh yes, I got the Mavericks. People were looking at the Lakers. Yeah, people were looking at the Lakers. We were really looking forward to a Kobe and LeBron finals. So the Mavericks go through the Thunder, who were our future Western Conference champions, the Lakers, the defending champions, and then they play the Miami Heat, who again had said they were gonna win like 8 titles. This was the one year of the Miami Heat that Dwayne Wade was still truly Flash. And he actually would have won the Finals MVP had they have won the series. And this is another one of those. You know how I said in 06 that if you go to the end of Game 3, it really looked like they were just outmatched. It looked like the Heat were outmatched. Well, in Game 2 of the 2011 Finals, it looked like the Mavs were outmatched. The Heat were up by like double digits. They were celebrating. The crowd was going crazy. It looked like everything they said in the party was true. and then they have the comeback, Dirk has the game winner, and the rest from there is just history. It's the reason that you can look at Dirk and say, although he only has one ring, like, man, that one ring is worth so many titles. To cap off a run, beating the freshly minted Miami Heat Big 3, and to be the finals MVP of that series as well, like, I honestly think that's why the Mavericks were so average after that finals. It kind of feels like after Dirk did that, he was like, well, damn, now what? How are you going to top that run? Yeah, that one ring boosts his legacy very, very high. And as if there was any question as to what number one was going to be, it's obviously the 2016 finals. Look, there were circumstances. Draymond got suspended. Boga got hurt. Steph had been hurt in that series. But that does not change the fact that, again, when you get to this tier of championships and narratives, Cleveland had been on a championship drought. LeBron had returned to Cleveland with the specific goal of winning them a title, which he had promised them way back. Golden State was making a run to be the best team ever. They had it record-wise, and all they had to do was cap it off and beat Cleveland in 5. Steph was the unanimous MVP. I still look back at the 2016 finals in amazement of how much of like a storybook it was. It was literally like somebody just sat down and wrote a story and made Steph the unanimous MVP and had the whole thing where LeBron had lost the 2015 finals, and like everything just seemed to be drawn out perfectly. And so, I remember when the Warriors went up 3-1, I didn't even have any more hype left to watch the rest of the games. On the day of Game 5, I was like, oh hey, yeah, there's a game tonight, but I was a little bit disappointed because I wanted the 2016 finals to be competitive. After what happened in 15, I really wanted to see them really go at each other. And it seemed like Golden State just had it in the bag. Much like it seemed like the Mavericks had it in 2006, and then Miami seemed like they had it. That was the feeling. Everybody, I really believe everyone on Earth was like, even if they were joking that Cleveland was going to come back 3-1, I think that everyone who had to bet would have said, yeah, there's no way for this to happen. There's no way possible that a 73-9 team with someone like Steph loses that lead. Just not possible. So for that to be the way that LeBron got his first title for Cleveland, you can't write anything better than that. That is the, I don't even know when another narrative like that is going to pop up for an NBA Finals series. I don't see it. Because it took so many years of LeBron failing and then going to Miami. And then for Golden State to come out of nowhere and seemingly take its shine. Like, it just took so much to lead up to that moment. And so yeah, 2016, I think that is the most important title. I am in total agreement with RJ there. And ranking these took a lot longer than I thought because I wanted to explain some things. So make sure to leave your list below. I mean, if you want to rank all 19, or if you would just change some of the order on my list. Because again, like I said, I'm sitting here looking at this list and there is no right answer. Some of you might value the Spurs titles more. Maybe you don't like the 06 Heat one that much. Like, this completely almost comes down to personal preference. I just think the only one that has to be universal, I think the 2016 Cavs has to be in number one. Even though 11 was amazing, I just don't think there's anything better than the 16 finals. And that's all for today. If you somehow followed this channel and didn't know that I had an even bigger one, make sure to go sub to Don2K where I do more long-form NBA videos. The link is in both the comment section and in the description. Hit the like button, comment, and sub if you enjoyed, and hit the bell next to my name if you want notifications on future videos. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you all in the next one.